What's up, geeks, and welcome to the channel. I believe that every developer should know the basics of querying and SQL, even if most full-stack frameworks have libraries for dealing with the SQL complexity like ActiveRecord, Doctrine, Hibernate, and more. But still, it is always nice to know what is really backing these frameworks instead of just using them. And that is why today, and as a follow-up to the database fundamentals video, I have decided to tackle this topic. Before starting, I just want to mention that in this video we will cover the basics of SQL statements. Later on we will upload more videos and further expand on this and many more subjects. So first, the create table statement. This statement will allow us to create a table in our database, and it expects the name of the table along with the columns we want to create and their respective types as arguments. As you can see here, we are creating a table named character with three columns, the ID of type integer, the name, which is a string having 30 characters at max, and the age of type integer also. If you need for some reason to create a column with type double, then you have to specify float in there because the double keyword is not a thing in SQL. Next is the insert statement. Of course, we didn't create a table to leave it empty, we want to add records to it. And to do so, we use the insert into statement, which expects from us the values we want to add to our table, just like the statement you can see. This one is compact, but has an issue. If later on we were to add additional columns to this table, it will break. Or if the values we are passing to the statement are not ordered in the same manner as the columns of our table, things will be messed up. In order to avoid this, it is preferable to specify the column names along with their respective values, as you can see in the second statement we just wrote. Anyway, whatever format you choose, both of them will add the same additional row to our table. Now that we mentioned it, to drop or add a column in our table after creating it, this is how we do it. We need to specify the column in question in case of deletion, and in case we are adding a column, we need to specify its name and its type. In this example, we are deleting the column name and then re-adding it. On top of that, we also added a new column that holds a string inside it named house. Now, you can see that we kind of messed up our table, because after removing the name column, we lost the value stored inside it. In addition to this, do you remember the insert into statement we used a minute ago? Well, if you are still using it without specifying the column names along with their respective values, it won't work unless you rearrange the order of the values you are passing as the age and name columns swapped places. This is why I said that the second format we wrote is a better approach to use. The next thing we would like to do is obviously get back the values we lost and update this record inside the table. So, to update a specific value, you will have to specify the exact record you need updated using the update and where keywords. The where keyword is needed because we want to update a specific record and not all rows inside the table. In the following statement, we are updating the values stored inside the column name and the column house for the row that has an ID of 1. If we had a lot of records in our table and we used the update statement without the where keyword, this statement would have modified the name of all the rows inside the table to match the one in the update statement. As you can see in this example, all the rows now have the same name value assigned to them. So make sure you do use the where keyword if that is not what you want. Now we kind of messed up our table again, and to fix it, instead of updating, what we are going to do is delete the extra rows we have. And that is pretty straightforward. Just specify the record you want to delete by making sure that the identifier is specific only to this row and it will be deleted. If you do not specify an identifier using the where keyword, you will fall into the same problem we just discussed, and all the records inside this table will be deleted. To fix our problem and return to our starting point in this example, we are going to delete all the rows with an ID greater than 1, and this was done in the second statement we wrote. A best practice to delete rows is to first write the query using the select keyword, execute it to make sure that it is indeed the record you'd be deleting, and then replace the word select with the word delete. Speaking of select, this one will take the remaining time of our video, as it has a lot of customizations that we will be covering. Let's consider that our table contains the following records. The simplest use of the select word is retrieving all these rows, and it is written as follows. An asterisk in SQL means everything, or all. We can retrieve specific columns from the table if we don't need all of them by specifying which of the columns we actually need. And we can also order these columns by adding at the end of the statement the order by keyword, as you can see. The order by keyword can be followed with ASC for ascending or DESC for descending to choose in which order we would like to arrange our records. Now, to select columns based on a specific condition, we can use the where keyword similarly to update and delete operations. So in this case, we are selecting the name and house of the characters with ID strictly smaller or less than 3. The condition can be more than a simple equality or a mathematical operator such as equal, greater than, less than, etc., but can be extended to make use of the and or logical operators. As you can see in this first example, we are selecting the name of the characters that have an ID less or equal than 3 and belong to House Stark. In our case, the statement making use of the OR operator will return the same results. The WHERE operator can be also used with the IN or BETWEEN keywords. The IN keyword allows us to select specific records where a certain colon value is in a set of other values. So it acts kind of like several equals chained along with the OR operator. On the other hand, the BETWEEN keyword allows us to specify a range of numbers in our WHERE clause. In our case, we are selecting the name and house of the characters aged between 10 and 25 years old. The last keyword that can be used with the WHERE keyword and I want to talk about is the LIKE keyword. What distinguishes the LIKE from the equals operator is that the LIKE uses REJECTSes to identify whether the two sides of the equation match or don't, and not simple equality. As you can see in this example, we used the percentage REJECTS and wrapped the letter S with two of them. This means that this SELECT statement will retrieve a character if its name contains the letter S. In this example, we have three characters that meet this criterion, Sansa, Daenerys, and Cersei. Another thing you can do with the LIKE keyword is use underscores. In the following SELECT statement, we specify that we need to select the characters whose names start and end with an A and contain only two letters between these A's. In this example, only one character meets this criterion, and it is Arya. Beside keywords and operators, SQL is packed with functions that can do a lot of stuff, like the max, min, average, sum, or the count functions, all of which can be used with the SELECT statement. Let's try some of these functions on the example we currently have. If we try to select the maximum age stored in our table using the max function, we will obtain indeed a single cell containing the maximum age we requested. And if we try to count the number of rows using the count function, we will also get the requested value, in our case a single colon with a single record equal to 5, as we have 5 characters. SELECT clauses can be nested. What I mean by that is, we can have two SELECT statements in the same query, like this one right here. In such cases, the inner SELECT statement is executed first, and the results of this SELECT will be used by the outer one. So, in our case, we will first retrieve the smallest age available in the whole table, and then get all the characters that have an age equal to this one. In our case, we just have one record meeting this criterion, but we could have had more than just one row. Sometimes we may have several tables in our database related to one another in some way, as we saw in Database Fundamentals video, which is also part of this series. Like in this example, let's suppose we have another table named Appearance. This table stores the series seasons and the character which was the most present in this specific season by number of episodes. So it will be linked to our initial table with the ID colon of our characters table. Now, we wish to select from both these tables at the same time. And to do that, we must join these tables. This way we are able to select columns from both tables with a single query. To join these tables, they must share a key or colon values between them. In our case, these tables are related with the ID colon, and that's the condition we provide the join statement with using the on keyword. So here what happened is that for each season we have, the character ID related to it allowed us to fetch the corresponding name of the character we are searching for. You may have noticed that it may be a bit frustrating to precede each column name by its respective table name, but in order to differentiate them, we have to. Think if both tables had a column with the same name. How would the query be able to know which of the columns you are trying to reference? To solve this issue, what you can do is use aliases by adding the AS keyword. This will allow you to reference the table in this query by a different alias, which you will be able to provide. Now, notice that in addition to the join keyword, the inner keyword was used alongside it, because, as you might have guessed, there is also an outer join. There are three types of outer joins, the left outer join, the right outer join, and the full outer join. The difference between an outer join in general and an inner join is that inner joins only return records that have matching data in both tables based on the condition provided to the on keyword we just saw. However, outer joins, on top of returning everything that the inner join returns, also fetch the data that does not have a match in the second table we are joining on. To get a better understanding of these notions, let's take a closer look at our tables. By the way, I did a small modification to the appearances table, and we will get to it in a bit. As you can see, in the character table, we have five records: Arya, Tyrion, Sansa, Daenerys, and Cersei. And not all of them are present in the appearances table. If you map their corresponding IDs to the colon-named character in the appearances table, you will see that we only have records of Arya, Tyrion, and Cersei, in addition to one last record which has an ID equal to 6 corresponding to Season 5 that has no record, no presence in our characters table, which is the modification I was referring to. So, if we take our tables as they are right now and apply the same exact inner join we applied a few minutes ago on them, these are the results that we will obtain. Arya, Tyrion, and Cersei only will be mapped to their respective season appearance, and because we have no record with an ID equal to 6, Season 5 will not be returned, nor Sansa and Daenerys. Now, to understand the outer joins, you have to know first that the table on the left-hand side of the join keyword is considered to be the left table, and the one on the right-hand side is the right table. Okay, so based on what we said, if we take this left outer join statement, the character table is considered to be the left table, as it is the one present to the left of the join keyword, and the appearance table is the right table. This left outer join will not only return everything that the inner join returned for us, but on top of that, it will return the missing records from the left table, which in our case is the character table. More specifically, it will return the two missing characters, which are Sansa and Daenerys, and that is exactly what happened, as you can see. If you take the right outer join version of the same statement, can you guess what it will return for us? Everything that the inner join returns, in addition to the missing elements from the right table, which in our case is the appearance table, and its missing record is the record from Season 5, because the ID it maps to has no corresponding record in the character table. Finally, the last type of our outer joins is the full outer join, and this one, well, returns the missing records from both tables, as you can see in front of you. The null values are now present in both sides of the results tables, in the left as well as in the right side. Everything is returned. I know it took a little bit of time, but we did manage to kind of cover the most important operations used in the select clause. However, a lot remains, so if you'd like to get a more in-depth learning on the subject, stay tuned as we will make sure to add more videos to our database series. So, that's it for this video. I hope it was helpful. Thank you guys for watching, take care, and I will see you in the next one.